Hi there, this is part 2 of the video on adjusting the trim pots in the UT210E to minimize the offset displayed in the DC amp range. Part 1 hopefully explained the theory why the UM210E shows these offsets, why you can reduce but not completely eliminate them, and why they keep changing when you change the orientation of the meter. Before covering the two procedures to adjust the trim pots in your UT210E, if your offsets are very high, I want to quickly go over how to measure currents correctly, because some of your problems may actually originate from there, and if so, you may avoid having to touch the trim pots in the first place, which is definitely the best solution. The best way to use the UT210E to measure DC current is to clamp the meter around the to be measured conductor while it carries no power. Adjust it or the meter so that the wire is roughly in the middle between the two arrow marks on the jaw. Press 0 to compensate for the offset caused by stray fields, and then, without changing the meter's orientation, turn on the power in the conductor you want to measure. If you need to measure the DC current in a conductor without being able to turn it off first, you need to trial or estimate what orientation of the meter will be needed to clamp around it, then hold the meter close but not too close in that position. Make sure that the clamp is closed to minimize picking up stray fields from the conductor or any others nearby, and press 0. Then clamp the meter around the conductor, making sure the orientation is as close as possible to the one when you press 0. This method has the drawback that it can't compensate for stray fields that are different between the place where you measure and the place where you zeroed the meter. The clamp itself is quite sensitive to touch, because it can easily cause tiny changes in the width of the air gaps. Needless to say, it has to close properly to begin with, or all your measurements are invalid anyway. But as a rule, don't touch anything with a clamp or force it into a bunch of cables, and never hold the meter by the clamp. The UT210E's clamp assembly isn't the strongest to begin with. On my meter, it turns out that this part had actually broken right through. You have to open the back of the meter to see it. I don't recall it ever being dropped, and it might have been damaged during shipping or in the factory. Anyway, since it makes the clamp even more sensitive against touch and handling, I decided to try and glue it, which so far has worked fine. If you have to do a similar repair, use something to keep the jaws open like this to avoid getting glue into the gap between the jaws. Avoid, if possible, proximity to neighboring conductors. This wire carries a DC current of just 2.5 amps, and you can see that it influences the reading even though it's outside the clamp. Occasionally, demagnetize the clamp, because the iron core will slowly pick up residual magnetism from the induced fields. So good metering practice reduces the possibility of adding unnecessarily to the offsets caused by the Earth magnetic field itself, and anyway, many may think, why worry at all, if all you have to do is pressing 0 to make the offset go away like magic. It's mostly about the available measurement range. If you had 0 offsets, you can measure currents in the full range, both in plus and minus direction. If you did hack your UT210E as I did, you may have an extended range that exceeds 6 amps in both directions. With a stock meter, you are artificially throttled down to either 2.2 or 2.5 amps, I can't remember which. If your meter has a non-zero offset and you zero it, a bug in the UT210E will cause the hacked meter to temporarily forget its extended 6 amp range and go back to the 2.5 amp limit. Apart from that problem, one could argue that all zero does is saving you from doing a subtraction in your head, and after all, you don't have to use zero. The trouble is, whether you press zero or not, the meter of course always measures from the real zero line to plus minus the range limit, and therefore a high offset reduces how much of this range is available for your measurements, be it DC or AC current. For example, if you had a whopping minus 500 milliamp offset shown in yellow here and zero it, then the meter will show overload when your measured current goes below minus 1.5 amps, but on the other hand, it will happily measure up to 3 amps positive current before showing overload. So in DC current measurements, a large offset can actually be used to your advantage as long as you can make the measurement current flow the opposite way, for example, by reversing the direction the wire is going through the clamp. But apart from such strange cases, you generally want the offset to be as small and as symmetric as possible around zero to enjoy the maximum range of AC and DC current measurements. So you may want to consider reducing an offset of 100 milliamps or more by adjusting the trim pots. The first problem you have to solve is how to power the meter during the procedure. A few steps in the procedure really require the meter to be on while adjusting the trim pots, which means it has to be open so you can use the built-in battery compartment in the lid. As you can see, the meter has those square contact areas on the PCB on which the metal springs of the battery compartment land when the back lid is closed. Next to the square areas are two round contacts, and some people use these to solder wires on to temporarily power the meter when the back is off. I decided instead to quickly fabricate this contraption, which is a piece of wood with two pogo contacts sticking out. It is shaped so strangely because it needs to still allow access to VR plus and VR minus. The leads go to an old battery compartment for two AA's from an old Poundland LED Christmas light set. Having a switch on the battery compartment is actually quite convenient because it allows leaving the meter range switch to remain permanently in the 2 amp setting. Here it is installed with two rubber bands. Not very pretty, but it works fine. It's a bit hard to see, but the springy ends of the two pogo sticks are right on the square contacts. You can also see that the contraption leaves just enough space to reach VR plus and VR minus on each side of one of the rubber bands. Absolutely essential for the long alignment procedure I'm going to present, but still quite useful for the short one, is some kind of holder, like this one are made of scrap wood pieces. I originally designed it to mount the meter upside down, so when using it display side up, it needs a piece of additional wood to ensure the meter is absolutely horizontal. Now you can also see that places where you can have rubber bands are quite limited because you still need to be able to operate the meter and read the display. The battery holder, which is not magnetic, fits underneath, which allows the meter to be easily rotated horizontally. Actually, the key benefit of the holder is that it keeps the meter always in exactly the same plane, which is essential for good results. In hindsight, that thing with the extra piece of wood is quite unnecessary. A tilt up or down is fine as long as it's always the same. Another benefit is, of course, that it helps to avoid touching the clamp, which we know is sensitive. But there are some influences you have to eliminate. Firstly, no magnets must be anywhere in the area where the alignment is taking place. Here I'm moving a reasonably strong neodymium magnet half a meter distance away, and the meter still picks up that field. The same is true for the tool that you use to adjust the trimmers. It must not be magnetic. If necessary, demagnetize it until the meter shows no effect if you bring it close. There are special tools for adjusting trim pots, but even these should be checked. Next, you need a piece of paper and draw a compass rose on it. It does not need to be very detailed, but you need to align it magnetically and stick it temporarily on your bench, which means you need a compass. Adjust your paper compass rose until its north-south line matches the compass needle. At the end of these preparations, you need to have it aligned and fixed on your bench like this. I collaborated with Dave, whose YouTube channel is NoKSWalker, on the alignment procedure of the trim pots in the UT210E. Dave has two of these meters, and he developed a procedure that worked very well for him in aligning his meters. I call this procedure the short one because it can be done reasonably fast and doesn't require taking lots of readings. His procedure uses VR4 to rotate the peak of the offset until it aligns with the north-south axis. He selected south as the reference for his procedure, but it would work equally for north. Dave's procedure exploits that the offset is smallest when aligned to the north-south axis, and that was certainly true for his 2 meters, and it's also true for mine. However, neither of us can come up with a reason why that should be universally true for all meters and for all locations. I feel compelled to offer a second procedure called long, which avoids this assumption and simply goes for the lowest offset directly. The drawback is that it's complex and long, and using a spreadsheet program is highly recommended. So a possible approach would be to try the short one first, and if it works for you, don't try the long one. The designers of the UT210E did not include this very necessary health warning. VR4 is so sensitive that for fine adjustments you don't turn it, but just sort of put pressure or lean on your adjustment tool to nudge the wiper a nanometer in one or the other direction. If ever there was a need for a 10-gang trim pot, VR4 is one. I have used the short method to align my meter and it worked fine. I then used the long method and managed to get a slightly lower offset, but the difference is only a few milliamps, and if it wasn't for verifying that the long method works, I would not consider it worth doing after a successful short method. I should also point out that I tried many methods before settling on the ones described, including mounting the UT210E over a mirror. While this approach works in principle, it aligns your meter to be used upside down because the sensors act differently depending on how the meter is oriented. If you do it this way and then use the meter the correct way up, you will be disappointed about the large offset now appearing. With the failed attempts out of the way, here's the short procedure condensed by me to 10 steps. A more detailed description written by Dave can be found at my GitHub page, link in the description. Steps 1 and 2 are doing a sweep to establish how well the peak of the offset is aligned with south. If that turns out to be the case, then you are done and all that's left is adjust VR plus and or VR minus until the offset is symmetrical. Since I already got one, I'm using a holder for convenience, but for the short procedure it is not essential. Doing the sweep with my meter starting at 13 milliamps when pointing west. You can see how the offset increases as we move anti-clockwise towards south, reaching 43 milliamps maximum over a fairly wide section. And then slowly dropping off again when I continue to rotate the meter eastwards. Ending at 15 milliamps due east. Well, 14 milliamps. Not surprisingly, my meter is well aligned since I already spent many hours on this. But in case yours is not, this is how this could look like. In this example, we read 12 milliamps pointing west over the course over the sweep. We find the maximum reading is 50 milliamps. However, as you have seen in the video just now, that max is spread over a relative wide section, so it's hard to say where the center lies. It does not appear to be due south because the east reading is quite different from west. A good method is therefore to turn the meter until it shows the max reading, that is 50 milliamps, and press 0. Then sweep westwards until you see, for example, minus 5 milliamps. Note the direction in which the meter is pointing. Maybe with a little marker you position on your compass chart. Then rotate the meter eastwards until you see again minus 5 milliamps. Mark that position as well. The center is then halfway between these two marks. In this example, the center is shifted towards the east and we must use VR4 to rotate it further clockwise. Adjusting VR4 is covered in step 4 of the short procedure. It assumes that the meter is upside down and you are looking at VR4 when doing it. This is how you would do it. Take the meter off the stand, turn it around and give VR4 a tiny nudge. Since my meter is now aligned after many hours of work, I'm too scared to even touch it. After the VR4 adjustment, you start a new sweep, you will get completely different offset values, so no point in remembering any values of the previous run. If your meter is well aligned towards south, you can proceed with step 6 to 8, which is to adjust VR plus or VR minus until you have the same offset in both directions. On my meter, the north reading is minus 10 and the south one 46. This means the absolute north-south difference is 56. The east reading is 19 and west 16, which is just 3. So ideally we want to trim via plus or via minus so that north changes from minus 10 to minus 28, because then south will drop from plus 46 to plus 28. Of course, adding that additional minus 18 bias will also affect the east-west readings, which will come to plus 1 and minus 2. Now, step 9 is a bit tricky, because you need to see the display while adjusting via plus or via minus, and as I explained, you have to keep it upright, so using a mirror doesn't work. The way to do this is to insert your adjustment tool into either via plus or via minus, keep it in there, and then carefully turn the meter the correct way without letting your adjustment tool slip out. Then you orient the meter to say north and change the trim pot until you read minus 28, in my case. Or you orient it to south and adjust it until you see plus 28. As to via plus or via minus, either one will work. In case you wonder, I did not have the intention to actually change the setting again in my meter, so I used the recessed end of my adjustment tool, which is for trim pots with a screw like a 10 gang type. For the ones used in the UT210E, that end will not turn the wiper. But as you see, just applying pressure on the trim pot is enough to change its setting, so now I have to readjust it again. But I do that off camera because it's so delicate and worse if you try to keep everything in camera view. Well, that's it for the short procedure. So, on to the long one. The gist of this procedure is to get 4 readings, one from each major compass direction. We need to record these 4 readings and then do some calculation. That's why I think a spreadsheet is the easiest way, but nothing stops you from doing it with pen and paper. Once we have 4 trustworthy values, we calculate the maximum offset and then adjust via 4 a tiny bit. Then we get the next 4 readings and repeat. Once we collected a few of these, a pattern will hopefully emerge, but first let me demonstrate getting the readings, because for this procedure to work, we need to be as accurate and consistent as possible. So using a holder to make sure the meter's tilt and slant is always the same, and careful alignment on our compass is absolutely essential for the long procedure. I'm showing this accelerated to save some time. We start at north with minus 7 as a reading. East is plus 25 or plus 24. South is 50 or 51. And west is 20. Now we go back. South is 51. East is 24, or is it 22? North is minus 7 again. We need to repeat this until we have a set of number that we can trust. So back to east, 24. Or 25. South is consistent, 51. West is 20 again. You get the point that you may have to spend some time in repeating this. Of course, you must make sure nothing else changes, like ambient temperature or bringing magnets into range or high currents flowing in the vicinity. Now you record your measurements. This is the original spreadsheet when I did it. I'm using LibreOffice, but it works identical in Excel. In fact, this file is even saved as an Excel spreadsheet. On the left, you see a running number of measurements as a reference. Then we have the 4 columns for the 4 directions. North, East, South, West. This is where you enter your data. Column F is the minimum of all 4 measurements, which you can easily get by using the min function. Column G does the same using the max function. Column H simply calculates the difference between max and min as an absolute value. In between each row, I adjust it via 4 a tiny bit, always going in the same direction. It does not matter which but once you decide it, you need to stick with it. If you observe the deltas, you can see that they get less and then larger again. Because the meter is so sensitive, a dip could well be caused by a small error in positioning the meter on the compass or an unstable reading. Therefore, you need to keep going with adjusting VR4 in the same direction for a few more measurements until you are quite sure that you passed the optimum with the lowest delta and now creeping up the slope to ever larger deltas. In my case, I decided after measurement 10 that it was time to reverse the direction of VR4. But because I did the short procedure before, my first measurement with a delta of 60 was already quite close to the minimum of 54. So I decided to go a bit further in the other direction just to make sure that 54 was indeed the lowest possible value obtainable. This is the reason I gave VR4 a comparatively massive tweak in the other direction and measurements 11 read 54 again. I kept adjusting VR4 in the new direction until measurement 17, and the rising deltas convinced me that 54 was indeed the best value. So I tried to jump back with another tweak of VR4, now back in the original direction, and landed at measurement 18, which was right in the sweet spot. A stroke of good luck? Not really. If I plot the measurements using north, for example, against delta, we see this curve. It shows exactly what I described earlier. I started here and then adjusted VR4 until I found this steep rise on the right. Then I jumped back and started to adjust VR4 in the other direction, finding the slope on the left, following by the incredibly lucky jump back into the minimum. What I actually did is looking at the north values and seeing that a value of minus 40 to minus 10 should get me there. So all you need to do is power up the meter, insert your adjustment tool into VR4, turn the meter the right way up, orient it to north and tweak VR4 until you see the target north value. It's much easier said than done, but it's possible. In my case, I stopped tweaking at minus 39 and took another round of 4 measurements. Seeing 54 as a delta, I decided to leave it at that. In fact, I literally left it, turning everything off and going for dinner. An hour later, I ran another set of 4 measurements without touching any trim pots, and although the values are a little different, the delta is not. A possible culprit is the temperature difference after 1 hour off compared to the long, continuous use from before. Just to finish off, part 2 of the long method describes what I just showed in the spreadsheet. You examine the deltas, try to establish if you are on the rising slope, and if so, reverse VR4 adjustment direction until you found both sides of the slopes with a valley of the optimum position in between. Steps 12 to 14 describe the trick on how to get back to close to the optimum position by taking one of the orientations. You don't have to plot the values as I did for this video. The ballpark number to adjust VR4 to is usually easy to establish by just looking at the recorded data. Step 15 is really only for people with very steady hands and nerves of steel. I don't think it's really worth the effort, and the errors introduced by even slight changes in orientation between measurements probably make this a lost cause. The rest of the steps are for the VR plus and VR minus adjustment, and they are identical to the short procedure, so I won't cover them again. And that's it. I'm sure if you made it until here, you are as relieved as I am that it's finally over. Dave and I spent at least 2 months on this, exchanging findings every couple of days. Dave even bought himself a second UT210E to have more meters to try his short procedure on. What I would really like to know is UNIT's procedure to adjust the trim pots in the factory. Well, that's probably something we will never know. In any case, for the money, the UT210E is an amazing meter, and hopefully with the help of this video, you can adjust the trim pots yourself with a good chance of success. Thanks for watching.